So you've met everybody. I'm Craig Hewitt, founder of PodcastMotor, and I'm going to talk today about kind of the evolution that we've seen in PodcastMotor as a productized service. So we've kind of touched on productized services a lot today, and just want to establish a baseline here. Who's familiar with productized services or has seen kind of some examples of them in real life? Okay, cool. Just want to make sure everybody knows generally what we're talking about. So the premise with a productized service is that they're a few things, and they're all of these things because they fit in a box really nicely. And we talk about product market fit, like for SaaS. The same kind of idea applies to a productized service. So the person who comes to your page sees what you're offering. It's very clear, the value proposition that you're offering and the type. Thanks for joining us. And the type of customer that would be a really good fit for it, right? So those two things kind of jive together. So looking at starting a productized service, they're usually very quick to launch. There's not 6 months of development time and user testing and all this kind of stuff. It's really, you know, hey, Brennan, I know you've been missing like half of your podcast episodes lately. Do you need some help editing your show? Oh, yeah, that'd be great. What's it cost? What's $500 a month? Okay, no problem. Most of the time, my friends who have started productized services have customers before they have a website, as opposed to my friends who are developing SaaS, where 6 months later, they decide to throw the whole thing in the trash, right? So not that it's not a SaaS, not a good model, they're just very different. Quick to, and easy to validate because you can validate it before you spend any time or money on the business at all. They provide immediate profit because you should be selling your service for a lot more than it takes your time or your contractor's time to fulfill it. Like I said, they have a very clear scope and value proposition, so the thing that you're delivering is very understandable and very concise and fits in that box that I talked about to your potential customers. And really the big thing that we saw like with WP Curve, which is really kind of the hallmark of productized services, I think, is they provide the ability for previously unprofitable business models to become viable. So WP Curve is charging $20 a month for unlimited WordPress fixes, right? That's crazy. But because they built the systems and processes and they hired the people at a cost, then it was then a viable business model. But... so what's the but? Anybody? But the question about productized services?
Scale.
Does it scale, right? Who remembers the BlendTech guy? He would put the iPhone in the blender, right? Does it blend, right? So that's the question. Does a productized service scale? So we're 2 years into PodcastMotor at this point, and I can say yes, they do, but, right? It's always the but. But a couple of things that just in transparency here, and we'll talk about some numbers a little bit as well, but your margins will only go down over time. So as you start looking at starting a productized service, Rob Walling talked about when he was starting Drip, aspirational pricing, right? What do I want to charge my customers? And then just work backwards to, okay, if I want to charge them $50 a month for my SaaS or $800 a month for my podcast editing service, what do I have to do to make that a solid value proposition? Because your margins will only go down over time. So at this point, PodcastMotor has 12 employees, one of which is full-time, plus content marketing that we pay for every month. So our margin has gone down as we've had to support the level of service and the number of customers that we have. So we have kind of bumped up against this ceiling in revenue 4 times now. And it sucks, and I can't figure out why or how to get over it. And I think the limitation is the business model a little bit. We have one full-time project manager who handles all of our customer communication and all of the kind of end fulfillment with the customer in our team. And I think she can only handle 30 customers. So if we want to double our business, we have to bring on another project manager and new audio engineers and new show note writers and all this kind of stuff, and our margin will only go down again. And you know, at some point, we'd have to have a whole nother level of management. So you know, Thomas talking about having 23 employees, he's probably seen this a lot more than I have, because he's 6 years into a similar kind of business model. There is the question of sellability of a service business, call it a productized service or not, but The fact is nobody wants to buy a job, right? If you're an investor and you want to go put $200,000 into something, you don't want to have to spend 20 hours a week on it. So currently with Podcast Motor, I spend zero time fulfilling our deliverable to customers. But it doesn't mean that I don't have sales and marketing responsibilities and things like that. So I do spend time kind of on a high level with our business, and probably similar to what like a SaaS owner would do if they're looking to grow the business. But that's only after 2 years and a ton of lessons that I'll talk about in a minute. And then it is a linear growth curve. So selling a service, you're only going to be able to scale as fast as your team can support that deliverable, as opposed to you're selling a book or a training product or a SaaS or whatever. You can sell 30 of them in a day, and it's no harder for you. With a service business of any type, you have to have the infrastructure and the people in place to be able to provide that service and fulfill the deliverable. So just kind of a quick timeline looking at the last 2 years of Podcast Motor. We launched in January of 2015, and within about a month, we had our first few customers, and we're doing over $1,000 a month. This is all recurring. As my first business, this is like, oh, yes, this is great, this is easy. And it really is pretty easy. I tell everyone, if you want to get out of a day job or kind of leverage your experience and expertise, the productized service is the easiest way to get started and start making money, just because it's so easy for everyone to understand and to start converting customers. We started adding team members, and within the first year, we had like 8 team members, and we started doing 10,000 a month recurring. So that was awesome. I felt really good about this. And this whole time up until here, I had a day job and I have 2 kids and was working about 15 hours a week on the business. So not so unlike kind of the power of SaaS. We had we had people on recurring billing. Money was coming in every month and the team was fulfilling a lot of our deliverables. May of last year, I quit my job. We started traveling Europe. I didn't work any more than I was with a day job. And we started launching products. So we launched a WordPress theme and a WordPress plugin that are both paid offerings. And later last year, we did our first 20,000 recurring month, which was awesome. This was, in the 30 customer range, and then we've been kind of hitting up against this for the past few months since then. And then in December, had a really interesting opportunity come just out of the blue. When honestly, I was at a point with Podcast Motor, we ran up against this number, 20, 25,000 a month, a couple of times, and we couldn't sustain it, we couldn't crack it. I was getting pretty disappointed. I was like, "Fuck, excuse me, this is really hard." And if we're losing customers, having to get them back just to get to the same point, this is not the kind of business I want to run. And then out of the blue, my friend Brad Tunard, who's a big WordPress guy, says, "Hey, my buddy is selling his WordPress plugin, has 20,000 active installs. It's a podcasting plugin. You should take a look at it." I was like, "Oh, that's great. Let's take a look at it." So I hooked up with Hugh, who now works for Automatic. Automatic has an agreement in there with their employees that they cannot profit off of WordPress-related products. So Hugh has this amazing plugin that has a ton of active installs, and he can't sell like a premium module or a SaaS add-on or anything like that. So he's like, "I just have to get rid of this." And we were able to acquire it with funds from the business, not from my personal funds. We were able to cash flow acquiring this WordPress plugin that has 20,000 of active installs. And now we're building a product off the back of it. So you're talking about like iterating and adapting a productized service to kind of be a different business in the end. It's kind of what we lucked into, but now with the beauty of hindsight, I would say if you're going to start a productized service, kind of have this goal in the end of getting into SaaS, getting into a product business, but a productized service is a great place to start. We launched a course in January called Launch in a Week, so we take all the knowledge we've accumulated over the last 2 years and tell people how to start a podcast just in 7 days. And we'll be launching Podcast Motor Connect next month, which is our media hosting platform, which connects with Seriously Simple Podcasting, the WordPress plugin that we bought, putting us on parity with providers like Blueberry, which are just huge businesses. So we're excited about the opportunities that we have. As we scaled, it was a really painful process. I mean, I'm not a type A person at all. I'm like a type C person. And so my like fly by the seat of my pants and figure it out as we go thing works for me. But when you start having a team that relies on you to for them to be able to do their job, it gets really hard if you don't document stuff. Because I'm not a type A person, I didn't know to document stuff. We hired really well. And what I mean by really well is we hired people who could do the job without the documentation. And just say, hey, Becky, just kind of take care of our customers and, you know, deliver the product that we're providing or that we're promising them. And so that was great, but it's also expensive. You have to pay those people a lot more than, you know, my friend Brian Castle that runs Audience Ops. He's able to hire people for probably half of what we might have. And so you think about a business like that as a lot more profitable. One thing I learned is that on a monthly basis, I would start identifying where I'm the limiting factor, not just in the regular fulfillment of our business, but in growing. So like, how do we bring on new customers? Oh, well, Craig's involved every time. Well, that's no good. I have to figure out a way to get around that. And we did. All the designers and developers in here can probably identify with scope creep, right? It's a huge problem in any kind of service business, and a productized service like we run is no different. So, you know, can you do transcripts? No, we can't do transcripts. Oh, well, okay, we can do transcripts. You know, it's fine, no problem. But you go out reinventing the wheel all the time. It is hard for you. It's really hard for your team. You know, hey, team, can you turn this around in 2 days? No, we tell everyone it takes a week to do a podcast. But, oh, Craig said it would take, you know, 2 days, so no problem. So they're up on the weekends, and they kind of resent you for it in the end. But having clear expectations on both sides of the fence. So for you and your team and for your customers makes everybody happy in the end. And then Thomas talked about retaining good customers, and that's super important, right, with a recurring business model. Retaining customers is the easiest way to have a sustainable business, but not having bad customers, I think, is just as easy. There's nothing more poisonous to a business than a pain in the ass customer. And if you can identify what those people look like when they come in the door and just tell them, well, it's $1,000 a month for you, or to make it worth your while, or I'm sorry, we just can't help you. You don't have to tell them why. I'm sorry, we can't help you. And we started turning away business in the last half of last year because I started seeing the pattern and say, oh, you know, this guy is going to be a pain. I know. And we're just not going to work with people like that, people who would email me 7 times in a day during the sales process. I'm like, hey, I'm sorry. We do this thing, and for the people that's what they need, it's great. If you need something very different, we're just not right for you. Let me recommend somebody who is. So SOPs. Everybody hates writing them, right? So we don't write SOPs anymore. What we do is we use this wonderful tool called Snagit. Everybody familiar with Snagit? It's amazing. Okay. So Snagit is it's like a freemium kind of deal, but to get the really premium, their premium version, it's like a $30 one-time download for Mac, and it allows you to screen record and do screenshots and annotate them, and it syncs directly to Dropbox or Google Drive. It's great. So that's after the second time that I do something in our business now, I do a screen capture of it, and I say, hey, this is da-da-da, I'm going to go do this, and I kind of talk through it generically so that anyone can follow it, not just our production manager, but so anyone down the road can follow it. It uploads it directly to Google Drive or Dropbox, and I take that link and I stick it in our process document and say, hey, when it's time for you to upload the show for XYZ customer, this is exactly how you do it. And there's no questions, there's no ambiguity, there's no anything about that. So if you're looking to start offloading things to customers or to your support team or other contractors, Snagit is just amazing. And it's $30. It's just, it saved my life because before I would write out everything in a Google Doc. I tried all the tools, Process Street and Sweep Process and all, and they're just too complicated because the fact is it's different every time you go to record a process, it's different. And so video, there's no ambiguity, there's no question about what you're talking about. So removing yourself from the business is kind of the goal of a productized service, I think, because then you're able to scale without you being the limiting factor. And so I set this goal to kind of do a little bit less in fulfilling our core offering every month, kind of starting in early last year, and that really helped a lot. But the big thing is to stay profitable and keep that margin the same, you have to ensure that when you're not working on fulfilling that product and you're kind of like getting out of being a one-man shop, that the value you're providing to the business is at least as high as what you're paying someone else to do. So if I have $5,000 in support cost a month, I have to be adding more than $5,000 a month in value to the business. And that's not simple, right? So you're gonna go sell and market and grow your brand and acquire other things and transition the focus of the business. All are things that take a lot of headspace and a lot of time to focus on. It's easy to say, I'll edit this one, or I'll write the show notes for that one, or I'll design this thing, or I'll develop this feature. But really, as a business owner, and to start getting out of the business, you have to think about how you can elevate the business as a whole a lot more than whatever your time or money would be directly involved in the business. Saying no to customers is a really empowering thing. And when you start doing it, it feels great and you want to do more of it. And as you start getting more clear about what your business is and who you are as a business, you start doing this more and it gets easier and you feel more justified with it. I encourage everyone to say no to customers a lot. They respect the hell out of you for it, and it solidifies exactly what you do and who you are in everyone's eyes, and especially your team. We tell customers, no, I can't turn that around faster. No, that's as good as it can get, the audio, because you have a shitty mic. Don't be afraid of it. Once you know kind of who your business is, it gets real easy. And then building accountability in a team, and I'm going to talk about this more in just a minute. So this is, right, this is where you want to get as a business owner. You want to be sitting on the beach, drinking a Mai Tai, and just having the money come in. And that only happens when you really give the power to your team. Thomas talked about it a little bit, where he doesn't get into the weeds with documenting processes and delegating things like that. He's really kind of arrived, right? He doesn't get into the guts of the business very often at this point. And as far as Podcast Motor and the real service that we do, I don't either. But it's only because I've kind of given the team the power and the authority and the autonomy to write SOPs, but also to improve upon them. So they come to me now and they say, hey, Craig, this sucks. The way we do this is not ideal. We're going to start doing it like this. Is that okay? Yeah. Document it. Tell the team about it. Let's do it. Let me know how it goes. And it's great. So now I don't have to be involved in making all of the decisions about how the business runs. I have people that I know and trust, and they have vested interest in the business running smoothly so we can acquire more customers and make more money. So what if I was starting from scratch today? I love thinking about this because we all learn a lot, right? As we go through a business, we learn a lot about, oh, man, that was such a bad idea, and I can't believe I did that, and this was such a naive thing to think. But the biggest thing and the number one reason that our customers churn is because we rely on them to do something for us to fulfill our service. I can't edit your podcast until you do an interview, right? So if I was designing kind of the perfect productized service from scratch, it would be something that me and my team can go do without needing anything. I can create Facebook ads and go put them up. I don't need anything from anybody to do that. I can go get the copy from your website, and we can have an interview once a month maybe to talk about what your goals are, and we can go and do it from there. You know, my buddy Brian that does audience ops, they write articles. They don't need much from us. They don't even talk to the customers about what they're going to write about. They just tell them, hey, this is the next 6 weeks of content we're going to write for you. Oh, that would be great. So it's a bit of a fundamental problem with the model that we have, and we're looking at some ways to get around it, because customers come to me rightfully and they say, Craig, we pay you $600 a month and I haven't recorded a podcast episode in a month. I don't really think that's fair. And I have to say, well, it's what you signed up for, right? You wanted someone to help you with your podcast, and we're helping you. The fact that you haven't recorded an episode is not really my fault. I mean, we work with them, but I feel like we're in a bit of a catch-22 with this. But so as you're thinking about potentially starting a productized service, the least you can rely on customer involvement, especially to start, the better. Everyone gets on the same plan or plans, and there's no exceptions. And if there's a lot of exceptions, then you're missing something. That product market fit we talked about, there's a problem, right? If someone says, oh, I want to do one every 6 weeks, and I want to do video, and I want timestamps, and all that. If you have to make exceptions for people all the time, then you're missing something, and create more or different plans for your potential customers. Document and delegate early and often, and this is just It's funny, I'm not type A and I'm a control freak, which is like the worst possible thing, right? So I think I'm the only one who can do this, even though I'm not going to tell anyone or document how to do it. But I would document from the very beginning how I do things so that if and when I want to start offloading it, it gets real easy, not this kind of just-in-time documentation and everything. And then talking about profit margin, I would shoot for at least 50% total business profit from the beginning, which means on a per customer cost, it's probably like 65% profit margin from the start, because it's only going to go down over time as you get managers and support people and paying for marketing and things like that. At this point, Podcast Motor operates between 35 and 40% profit, which I think is cool, right? We're talking to Andrew. SaaS businesses are 80% profit. So we have to do a lot more volume to make the same amount of money. Not that it's bad, because a productized service is a great kind of launching point and path to a lot of different types of businesses, but just make sure you're making money along the way. There's a lot of unprofitable productized services out there, I think. Thomas talked a lot about selling your business, and this is a quote. I'm glad he's not here anymore. This is a quote from another broker talking about selling productized services, and they do sell, right? They are sellable businesses, I would think, especially something that's highly standardized and documented, and the team fulfills the indeliverable to customers. But 2x net profit is bad, right? You can sell a SaaS for 4x, so double. So for making the same amount of money, selling a productized service gets you a lot less in the end. We were talking about, you know, is it a good business model? Am I happy with what we've done with Podcast Motor? Yeah, but just because we're kind of evolving into something different. If I had spent 2 years building up a business that's only worth what an AdSense site would be worth, I could have made a lot more money in that time. So not to spoil the fun, but a productized service is a great business model. But it has some drawbacks, and it's only a good business model if it's just the beginning. So a couple of my friends and a couple of people that everyone knows here, Steli Efti, everybody know the story of Elastic Sales? Steli's a big personality. He does the Startup Chat with Heaton Shaw. It's a great podcast. We do their stuff. It's wonderful. But so these are a couple of my friends, Justin McGill and Brian Kessel, started Productized Services around the same time we started Podcast Motor. Justin is doing about $35,000 a month with his SaaS now, LeadFuse. It started as a Productized Service. Brian is just getting ready to do kind of beta launch of his Audience Ops Calendar. It's a kind of content management system and content marketing system for writers and social or for blogging and social media. But Elastic Sales is really an interesting one. So they started out kind of as like the AWS of Salesforce, right? So, hey, I need 2 sales guys this week. I need 10 next week. I need 3. So it would just scale as you needed them. And what they found is that it was sort of tough for people to understand and tougher to implement. But at the same time, they said, the CRM market is horrible, and we can do a lot better, right? And so they baked their own CRM, and that's what Close.io is. They went into Y Combinator, I think, to sort of fulfill that. But Steli started, he's a sales guy through and through, and started with a service business and grew a team, and it was very successful. But they quickly saw the opportunity with a SaaS and kind of pivoted into that. And that's what we're doing with Podcast Motor. We've released some one-time products around WordPress and a course, and now we're building our media hosting platform, which should be here soon. And I'm very excited about it. So, you know, diversifying our product offerings is a really exciting thing to do as a business owner, to know that we understand the industry really well. We have a lot of customers and a good name recognition, a good audience. We're able to cash flow the investment and the development of all of these tools. And now it's becoming a much more well-rounded business, which is pretty exciting. So Brennan Dunn talks about surrounding the problem of freelancers. And everyone knows Brennan, he's the guy for freelancers and Double Your Freelancing, right? And so he says, you know, he has multiple types of customers in different market segments with different products, and he allows multiple ways for people to say yes to him. And I love this analogy. And we're doing this a little bit now with our business customers who have typically been our only customers, subscribe to our concierge service. They just want someone to take care of all of the stuff that goes around podcasting, right? Do the editing, do the show notes, do transcript, publish to my site, do, you know, schedule social media, and we do all that, right? So that's our business customer now, and that's great, and we'll always cater to them because that's kind of where we started. New podcasters, we'll be able to offer them, you know, like a startup package or our course or our hosting platform. Existing podcasters who already have a show going on, we can give them ongoing support, and we can provide our SaaS offering to them as well. And then for the DIY podcasters, which is the biggest part of the market, we have a lot of non-service related offerings that we can give them. And then there's this trade-off over here of the trade-off in value with market size. And I think this applies to most markets, right? As you go more mass market, the value that you deliver probably is going down. As you niche down, get more into the B2B space, your value per customer goes up, but your total potential market goes down. So it's just a trade-off you have to kind of know and acknowledge. And when you look at going into, oh, my slide got messed up there, huh? That's great. As you look at going into more of a mass market thing, you have to know that you're not going to sell an $800 thing to a bunch of people. You're going to sell a $15 a month thing. And along that spectrum is just a consideration that you have to kind of keep in your mind and acknowledge and kind of be okay with and plan for with the type of business that you're building. So really, in the end, it's a great place to start if you want to validate a market without the upfront time and money investment that goes into something like a SaaS. If you want a quick path to revenue and profit to replace your day job income. If you want to take a business that can cash flow development of a product, it's a great path. And if you just want to monetize your expertise and build a brand and an audience around a problem, it's a great place to do it. And a great way to do it quickly and without a lot of headache, really. I mean, it's a pretty quick pill to take. And I think that if you're able to pivot away from the service model in the end, it's a really cool way to go. That's it. Get the benefit of being last, so there's not as many. Oh, there's questions. Okay. Yeah.
Like, very curious.
Me too. No, so it's really, it really ends up being multiple types of customers, multiple market segments. And we run into this with our marketing efforts a lot. If you've read any of our blog posts, they are not catered towards our current customer. Right, we write a lot of DIY how to podcast better articles, and some of our, you know, concierge level customers will read those and say, how do I record better audio? But for the most part, our business customers just want someone to fix the problem and take care of what they're trying to get accomplished. As we're moving kind of up this way in the market, we're moving towards the DIY crowd, which is a lot of the content and the audience that we have that we haven't been able to monetize in the past. So I think a lot of our brand is around, you know, the blog that we have and around providing this service. But a lot of our customers for our SaaS, for our hosting platform, will come from the active installs of our WordPress plugin. So we bought the plugin just for the active installs. It's 20,000 installs, but it's not making any money. So we bought it just for the potential of developing paid add-ons for it. And I think it'll be interesting to see how those convert. But I think we're talking about like you were talking about matching your offering with your audience and what they need. I think it makes sense, right? The people that are doing a podcast and it's in WordPress, that for them to have a dedicated media host makes sense. Everyone else does it. They just haven't had a good option for it in the past. So, yeah, to your point, we're going to start talking to two very different crowds here pretty soon. Yeah?
How do you feel about the prospects for people starting new podcasts now? Why do people do it? Should they be doing it? Is it
yes.
A good ROI? I mean, I understand you're incentivized to tell people to start podcasts, but you know what I'm getting at, right? Like, there's so many now.
Yeah. Pause for dramatic effect. There's a handful of podcasters in here. It is the best way to build your authority. And that's all, the recording's off. That's all it does for me, right? We have a podcast for PodcastMotor, and I have my own podcast. And all that my goal is with both of those is to build and establish authority. With our PodcastMotor show, it's about me as an authority and us as an authority in podcasting. And we do that through interviews and kind of leveraging other people's experience and sharing those messages. And for me, you know, my personal show is just kind of sharing the things I'm learning, but also a way to kind of share my message and the things that we're doing with a bigger audience. I think if you're starting a show for your business, you have to look at it as a marketing avenue, just like blogging or just like YouTube or just like social media. And you have to know that it's going to take a year of sucking, right? And taking a bunch of time and not having a lot of subscribers and not really being able to tell who's listening and where they're going in your funnel. I mean, you can do some creative things with like podcast-specific landing pages. It's not anywhere else. You don't link to it from your website directly, but just the people who are listening to your podcast can go to, you know, mysite.com/show and see the thing you're talking about. But I think that the thing with podcasting and a little bit of like video is that not a lot of people are doing it, even now. You know, but compared to blogging, right? Everyone has a blog. Conservatively, half the people have a podcast. And I think when you look at starting a podcast in 2017, it has to be coming from a different angle. So you're going to talk about entrepreneurship and a podcast. You better have a cool way of doing it. And really, you're going to have on John Lee Dumas, but don't talk to him about Entrepreneur on Fire. Talk to him about, you know, whatever, being in the army or growing up, whatever. You know, talk about, you know, we tell you like it's becoming saturated, so you have to find a different angle to take or the same angle with very different people. And that's what we're doing with the PodcastMotor show is we're getting on people that a lot of our current audience hasn't heard of and sharing cool ways that they're engaging with their crowd through their podcast. That's kind of how we're using it as a marketing tool. Yep.
How do you come up with an idea for a productized service?
I think coming up with ideas is a very dangerous thing. I think the Amy Hoy 30 by 500 thing is...
How did you decide to do
it? Oh, how did I?
For example, rephrasing the question, so it's not that vague.
Uh-huh. Yeah, so I started my podcast just over 2 years ago, and after about the second episode, I said, well, this is really hard, right? Like, wow, it takes 3 hours to do an hour worth of audio. I bet a lot of people who are business owners are doing this right now and saying, wow, this is really hard and takes a lot of my time. There has to be a better way. And so, yeah, I talked to two of our first three customers and said, hey, what do you think about just trying this? I won't even charge you for it. And if you like it, we'll kind of go from there. And that's what we did, and they both loved it because I took a huge problem off their hands and just solved the entire thing. And we grew very sort of painfully from there. Yeah.
Everybody's saying that you should never do it for free because it doesn't validate. Well, in retrospect, was that a good decision to offer it for free?
Yep.
Yeah?
Yeah. Well, no, so the expectation was that it would definitely be paid.
Later on. Okay.
Yep. But
how long did you offer it for free?
Once.
So like 1 month?
No, one time.
Oh, one time.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I thought that'd be like half a year free.
No, it's like a free trial. Yeah.
Okay. No, then obviously that.
And we do that to this day.
And it's not like free. It's just a trial. Okay.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
We do that to this day. We don't advertise it, but if someone says, hey, love to sign up for your thing, but I just want to see kind of what it's all about. We give them a lot of social proof. You know, we do the Pro Blogger podcast, and we do the Startup Chat, and we did James Altucher for a while. You know, we're legit, right? But if you need to see what it's all about, we'll do the whole deal for an episode with no charge.
So who are the people at your back end telling you your hiring story?
What's that? Yeah.
How did you make hires? What were the top decisions, I guess?
Yeah, no, I have my secret sauce in that. So we've hired most of our people through Upwork. surprisingly. Of our audio engineers, we have six of them. Two are Canadian, two are in the US, one is Irish, and one lives in Lebanon. And of our writers, all of them are in the US. And that's just, you just can't get around it. Like for us, we have to have native English speakers writing for us. We tried very hard to take shortcuts and hire a team in the Philippines just for cost effectiveness measures, and it didn't work. And so we raised our prices to be able to afford high quality people. But the best place to hire writers is the work from home mom crowd. And I will hire as many people from there as I can because there are several things. One, they have a lot of time during the day. They're US-based, so from a time zone perspective, even now living in France, it's not exactly ideal. But they are very reliable. They often have at least a college degree, if not a graduate degree. And they know exactly what you want, like the first time. So of our six writers now, three of them are from WHM, workathomemom.io or .org, and they're our best employees. And our full-time production manager is from there as well. It's a great place to hire really talented, really dependable, and very fairly priced people. Because, I mean, it's the perfect remote work situation, right? I have from like 9 to 3 every day where I'm just, you know, I have a lot of other things going on, but I can definitely work 3 or 4 hours a day. And it's been a great place for us to hire people. So content writers, production managers, admin types, it's wonderful. Social media marketing, I would think, would be wonderful.
I wouldn't normally add to what you're saying, but I love this point so much because we did the same thing at Churnbuster. And we had the benefit of hiring somebody that we knew personally, like a family member. It was a really sensitive business, so we had to have somebody we could really trust and justify to our customers why they were involved in collecting people's credit card information. But for us, the huge win was that we could offer that person more than they could get anywhere else at that stage in their life. And so it was it meaningfully impacted. I know that the money that they got from them working for us was sending their kid to private school. And it's like, a big part of why a lot of us do this is the lifestyle aspect of running a business. And that was the number one biggest life hack ever, was being able to like give that to somebody.
Yeah.
An incredible at-home job. Tons of money at.
Yeah. It's a super powerful remote workforce demographic. Yes?
As we're at the topic, so I guess that means that you're not using audience ops for your content. And I would also be interested in how long, on average, your articles are and how much you pay effectively, like either in terms of hours for your stay-at-home month or you know, how many they charge.
Sure, yeah.
Generally about your content
month. Yeah, so we audience ops is really good. Don't get me wrong. We were one of their sort of first customers, and we're with them for about a year. And what I realized and what we kind of found is that for me to be a more complete entrepreneur and business owner, I had to figure out how they do what they're doing, right? So hiring someone to just do it all for you is fine, but like, if I want to start another business, I don't want to go have to hire them again. I want to be able to say, I can hire this person, I can write the SOPs, I can delegate it, I can put a content calendar together, and we can do it ourselves. Because if you look at, you know, growing a $100 million business, you're not going to hire audience ops for that kind of business. So I wanted to be able to understand and implement content marketing at least as good as they do, which is the reason we kind of took it under our own roof. And we were bad at it for the first couple months after that switch, because the fact is they're a great productized service and they do a very specific thing very well. And for me to kind of reverse engineer what they do took a couple of months. At this point, we have she's not full-time, but it's almost her only role within our business, content writer. And we write weekly articles that are at least 2,000 words. And she does promotion of them, publishing, images, and we do like infographics and cool stuff now, social media scheduling. I do email just because we haven't gotten that far yet. And I do a lot of other stuff in drip, so it's not hard for me to write a little 200-word, you know, intro to the email. And we pay her $1,800 a month, which is what audience ops would cost. So if you think about that's, you know, $400-something an article.
And does it work at home?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah, she used to work in marketing at Apple. So we're getting a steal. So I pay her $1,800 a month for the content, and she writes show notes for a handful of customers. But I think our, I don't know, I think our content's great. Yeah. It's an investment.
The writers who do write show notes, do they actually listen to the whole episode?
Yeah. Yep.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah, it's hard. It's really, it's the hardest thing to hire for. To have someone understand, like, oh, you want a transcript? I don't want a transcript. Oh, I'm just going to listen to pieces of it and write bullet points. No. So we write about a page, and it's, you know, hey, today we're talking about da-da-da-da, and in this show we talk about da-da-da-da-da-da, and here's, you know, Jane on social media, and here's FemtoConf.com, and all this kind of stuff. So it's a pretty good formula at this point, but yeah, it just takes time. The audio guys do the same thing. They listen to the whole episode. So we pay our audio people on a per episode basis, fixed amount per episode, and we write our, pay our writers hourly. Yep.
What were the typical red flags for our customers you send
out? Looking for more than we offer is really the big one. You know, can you do this or can you do that? The ones who come in and say, I understand that you do A, B, and C, and that's exactly what I need, are pretty much the only new customers that we take at this point. Just because growing our service and morphing it around what a customer wants is really painful. Because our team doesn't understand, you know, like Becky, our production manager, understands because she's been with me for a year and a half, like full time, and understands that it's just crazy. But, you know, our team just doesn't understand that, oh, they want it like this, and why is that, and what's Craig done, and all this kind of stuff. So it's just easier to say, we don't really need more customers right now because our focus is shifting a little bit. So we're only taking customers that fit in our little box. And anybody that's outside of that, we recommend to some other services that do slightly different things.
When you were first starting, were you getting feedback from people that was like, oh yeah, you could do this, or was there a point where you were taking feedback and then you, like how did, what was the calculus there where you were like, okay, we need to start saying no to people? Like,
yeah.
Stuff that we've said yes is good enough.
Yeah. As a blurry line, I guess. But yeah, so when we started out, we just had our concierge service. We take and upload it and publish your, to your website and all this kind of stuff. And so it's obviously more expensive because it involves a lot more of our time and is very sensitive. We had people coming in saying, I really want to do this, but I just can't afford, you know, $600 a month at that time. And so we said, okay, what if we just do the audio work and the show notes and then give you that back for you to publish? We were able to knock about 30% off our price with that. For us, that still has a higher margin just because going in and publishing things to people's sites takes fucking ever. Excuse me. And so the only one after that was transcripts. You know, hey, can you do transcripts? Of course. You know, and then we hiring a transcriptionist is really hard. If you guys ever want to do it, don't just let me know. I'll turn you on to the guy we have in the Philippines who's a medical student and writes transcripts for us. And so she charges us $20 an episode and we charge our customers $45. But those were, after that, we kind of had rounded out what our offering was. And the people that come in and want something, you know, a downloadable PDF transcript that's branded with my image on it and stuff, I'm like, that's just, no, we don't, that's hard, you know? Going outside of our box to do that is hard. And we didn't hear a lot of it. People ask us now about, do you do marketing for my podcast? And that would be incredibly hard, you know, because we'd have to understand SaaS and understand construction, understand business intelligence and health and fitness and finance to be able to market people's shows well. We've had a lot of requests for that as a service. It would be like creating another business. Cool. Thanks.